Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Janice has it. Oh, no, she has the prayer. Oh. If you want to go to Children's Chapel, you better go now. We'll start preaching and it'll go on.
The first reading comes from the book of Acts. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. And then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is number 31, and we will read in unison. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Incline your ear to me. Make haste to deliver me. Be my strong rock, a castle to keep me safe. For you are my crag and my stronghold. For the sake of your name, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that they have secretly set for me. For you are my tower of strength. Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord God of truth. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me. A reading from 1 Peter. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus told his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you to go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. The past is not dead. It's not even the past. Probably heard that. William Faulkner wrote it in a minor and rather grim short story called Requiem for a Nun. That's probably the only thing I remember about it. The quotation was really just a turn of phrase, has been used and recycled and plagiarized and memorialized and revered. And it's a stalwart statement for those of us who worship the past. Because we all do. Our story sanctifies the meaning of our life. If that idea gets ripped off so often, it's because it rings true. It reminds us that our lives really are a collection of moments and that our past informs and shapes us. That's just basic old epistemology, how you know what you know. You know what you know related to something else you know, and so your memory is a key player in your understanding of reality. Okay, if that makes your head hurt, I'll add my historian son's classic and important line, "Those who do not remember the past are doomed to repeat it," though we don't remember that in our past very well. It's the phrase that catches me, though, that sounds way... The phrase that catches me about remembering the past is the past isn't dead. What past? Whose past? Your memory of the past and how the past was for others? Uh-oh. All of a sudden, memory becomes a living thing. It can be changed. I can verify the presence of something with my own memory of being there, but there's so much about this world that I don't know because I'm not there and I have to believe other people. I was not with George Washington as a child when he chopped down the cherry tree and his father came and asked him, "Did you chop down the cherry tree?" And George Washington said, "I cannot tell a lie. This is patently, completely, and totally false. There is no record of this story. It was made up after the fact. But our memory tells us what to think sometimes. We like to think that our president is so honest that he wouldn't even lie to his father about cutting down a cherry tree. This represents a triumph of our hope over our experience." So memory is a tricky thing. It can bend and twist and embellish and fit into our frame of reference. And we can subvert memory to protect ourselves. We can interpret a memory as something about fear that informs us to be afraid of something that may or may not still hold sway in our life. So much of what happens is in our cerebral mind, what we react to, the difference between what I see when I see a cat and what Calvin the dog sees when he sees a cat are functions of memory, or even deeper for him, if it is a threat and or if it is food, maybe I should go get it. So we fabricate a great deal in our mind as well about the truth of things through our memory. And as we like to say in AA, everyone experiences trauma. Some of it actually happens. See, our minds can get going. And we can do traumatic memory stuff. There's been a lot in the news lately about memory and its reliability. Traumatic memories are real, but they may not be as real as accurate, but we don't know, and we're healed through revisiting them. And our imagination probably adds the details. To this day, when I think of driving in England, I think of driving on the right side of the road because that's where my brain puts the memory. Strange to be in this head. Speaking of memories, a formative one for me was when I was a very young adult. My best friend died in a freak accident. Fell off a rope swing. Come on. We were close, and we lived together in college, and we shared a very half-hearted commitment to our fraternity. And for years after he died after he got married, and he was supposed to be our best man. And for years after it, I mourned him. I still do July 13th every year, Bastille Day. That's a much longer story. But then I had to kind of get back to that memory. It took me a long time to go back to him and see him as anything other than perfect. Of course, I had to go back and remember his reckless behavior, his wildness, his risk. He had just gotten into law school. He'd just gotten married. Why? So I had to come to terms with the fact that I was mad at him for being so stupid and screwing up not just his life, but ours. So I live with that. I try to edit my memory and see this person whole, not make him the Christ figure of my life. But I had to feel it, not just let it happen. That friend of mine was a flawed and terrified human being, just like me. And something happened. So when I speak the words, "life is short," I'm remembering to feel that life is to be seized now, because it's really all we actually have, because we are bound up by time. The blessing of God crosses time. Remember when I start that thing life is short, et cetera, et cetera. But then it goes down to a blessing, and the blessing of the God who made us, who travels with us, and who remains with us forever is across time. God's already tomorrow. Wait, that hasn't happened yet. Well, it has for God, because Jesus tells us this in this sacred memory we leave today. So remembering is not just recollection, and it can certainly become nostalgia, but remembering is a sacred act where we see God at work where we were. Isn't it easier to understand how God works in the rearview mirror? But memories are tricky. We have to test them all the time. What we do here, though, is an important weekly remembering. But it's not just like remembering, like you and I share a memory and that's it. There is a liturgical remembering that's going on. I call it re-remembering. There's actually a Greek word for this, anamnesis, that's used when they talk about remembering stuff in the Bible. And it's not just, let's talk about the old college days. This is the kind of memory that sanctifies who we are. We get together and remember things, September 11th, July 4th, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, Christmas, Easter, Sunday. This whole thing is for our memory. It's for the now, but it's to build it in. Because when we get out there, it's hard to remember that we're not the star of the show, or that we're not the victims of some trauma, or that something in the world doesn't make sense. If we approach it with a better sense of who we are and remember that, we remember the wrong stuff. Most of us remember that somebody corrected us once, and forever we decided that they don't like us. We create these dramas in our head, and we really have no evidence except our intuition, which is reliable. But Jesus, we remember today, he particularly comes to them and says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And a Christian sees on that and say, see, you must have Jesus. Otherwise, you'll never get there, and you can't. That's way above our pay grade. What Jesus is remembering for his disciples today is really a pastoral message. They're saying, Jesus, you're going to leave? Where are you going, and how can we get there too? Because we've been following you the whole way. And when he gets to that point, they start to realize, oh, we're supposed to keep doing this. But then he tells them in this, because they're thinking they've got to do something, go somewhere, be something, become something, for Jesus to use them and for God to love them, and that they're part of the plan, and if they don't have a sense of their role, they got to go. So we feel the same way. We really want to advise God on what to do next. And what Jesus says is, I'm already there. I'm already where you're going. I was with you in the past, remember? I'm with you now, live and in color. I'm there too. You see, the funny thing about you people, you're stuck with a limited resource. Time. We see it as limited because of biology, because of our limitations, because of our boundaries, our limits. I spoke about this last week. God doesn't have the strictures and the boundaries we have. So we need to be careful, especially in this Jesus, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Not to get amnesia about what that memory was for. It's for us, to give us food for the journey. If people come to Jesus down the road, that's their business and God's, and I trust them. God. Trust God. Even our memories need to grow in wisdom and grace. Our memories can be reformed. We have to be careful. I agree. It's hard to differentiate sometimes our memory from our reality. And it's just as real either way. So we practice. We come back here and hear the words of and actions of Jesus to know him better. We come back here to remember, to re-remember, to hope. because that's the fuel that drives the future. And hope drives the future because our experience with it in the past is this simple. A friend of mine at clergy conference, I was facing a big struggle, and he said, "Oh my gosh, what am I going to do? What am I going to do?" And I said, "Well, God's there already." And we both laughed about it. He said, "Yeah, and in my experience with God," this was the profound moment, "it's always turned out all right." Sharon's nodding her head. She's singing, "Every Little Thing Gonna Be All Right," the reggae song. And that may sound sappy, but it's true. Everything is going to be all right. That's what Jesus tells his disciples. That's the message. That's what we need to remember. Everything will be all right. It may not be comfortable. It may be painful. It may not be what we see or perceive or any of it. But that hope which drives the way we interact with the world better be rooted in memory. Don't forget it. Don't forget it. Hope is living out of what we remember to believe about our future. Our memory is so much part of us. And if memory serves, everything thus far has turned out all right. Not even the past is dead, because often it will rise up and show us the way. Amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again.
Prayers of the people are Form 6. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark, Gail and Dabney are bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, especially Christina Fernandez, Jenny Vernon, Elias, Dan, the Hamby family, Chuck Pace, G. Shiflett, EWC, Elizabeth, Tom Farrell, Beth Colmery, Jim Jewett, Holly Fuller, Grace Stearns, Clark Stearns, Western Herndon, Bruce Heflin, Don White, Candace Moore, Janet Crocker, Jake Kirchner, John Sandage, Karn Mott, Doris Savage, and Sarah Reynolds. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, our God and King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom, especially Martha Craddock, Judy Klickner, and Paul Hesselink. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon
us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown,
things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you and forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
No, fist bump. Yeah, I'm not kissing you, but I like you, but that much. Please be seated. We do all that to remember that we're forgiven. We've probably sinned since then. Keep coming back. Good morning, I'm JT, John Thomas, the rector here. If you're new visiting, we're glad you chose to come among us. If you've been before but want to know more about us or like to be known, please stop by the welcome table. Harry Lankenau will be there, very happily greeting you. We have a swag bag if you want some Emmanuel swag, but more importantly, if you really want to know what's going on and how you can be a part of our ministry, because this is our ministry, sign up with an email, and we'll send you an email once a week, that tells you what's going on at Emmanuel Church. We try to save stuff to go in there, and unless it's a death or a timely reminder that we forgot about, that's how we do it. Also, just a matter of, we're messing with our bulletin a little bit. I want to point something out to you. It says Emmanuel Episcopal Church, and at the masthead now, it says all of us, ministers. All those other people have particular jobs. They're very limited. You're not. So I was reminded of that in a recent meeting, and I'm grateful for it. So, announcements. Tom Duke.
Good morning. Commend for your reading in the bulletin the blurb about the new Crozet Cares Closet. The first ministry of the Crozet Interfaith Ecumenical, the Crozet Region Interfaith Council. which is a group of 10 churches in the Crozet area starting a new outreach ministry. The first ministry will be the Crozet Care Products Closet, which will be in Scott House. It will be to supply personal care products to those that need them. These are products, surprisingly, which are not included under the food stamp program. You can buy a loaded sugar soda, but you can't buy a bar of soap with food stamps.
How does that make you feel?
I understand some have already contributed. Thank you. If you have any questions, please email Susan Duke. And the opening of the closet will be July 1 in a couple months.
Thank you. Yes, that group it's the Crozet Regional Outreach Committee, with the unfortunate acronym of CROC. Just happened that way. But that group has been purchasing shelving and collecting some seed money, and we will help as well to make shelving downstairs, not unlike we have upstairs, that will kind of meet the need of the non-food but non-provided items that people need. I don't know what I'd do without Dawn dishwashing liquid in my life. I just don't. And I'm not even sponsored. Any other announcements? Coming up is our Pentecost picnic, Memorial Day weekend, that Sunday. Heather, you want to tell me anything I'm supposed to say? Sign up. It's on Sign Up Genius on our big old page of things to sign up to do. Just tell us so we can have an idea of how much chicken to buy. Some of you will have extras because it's Memorial Day weekend. Bring them. Some of you won't be here. We'll let the extras eat your chicken. Are we having a chicken off? Heather?
No, just Brownsville.
Just Brownsville Market. Okay. All right. There are rival chickens out there. Just have to be aware. Birthdays or anniversaries? Hello.
Hello. Harper celebrated his birthday yesterday.
Aww. And did you take Mary Catherine to a nice dinner? Very good. Wow, that's the old school where you take your parents at UVA place. Yeah, I went there as a prospective student.
It's Ellis' birthday on Thursday.
All right. What's the party going to be like?
Yeah, painting horses, miniature horses yesterday.
Painting miniature horses?
Yes, like canvas.
Oh, very cool. Very cool. And he's bringing art now, so there you are. All right, any others? Ho, ho, ho. I know. She brought her mommy to remember that for her. She was there too. The Lord be with you. Let us pray, O God. Our times are in your hands. Look upon these servants as they begin another year, and bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them as they stand. Comfort them when they are discouraged and sorrowful. And may your peace, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I have one question. Did the sermon happen? Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to God.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed his death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Hallelujah. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Stand in front of this table. Usher will tell me. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Finally, my friends, life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God who made us, who loves us, and who travels with you be with us all now and forever. Amen. It's going to be all right. That's the gospel.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.